How do your rigs sit underwater? What can fish actually see? How do you cast and bait up accurately? And what do you need to catch consistently? I've been a carp angler for over 30 years and a diver for nearly 20. I spend a massive amount of my time underwater studying carp and carp fishing. I've seen the best and the worst. I've swum with them, watched them feed, and studied their behaviour and characteristics. In total, I've got hundreds of hours of knowledge and some incredible underwater footage that I'm more than happy to share with you. Welcome to Understanding Underwater. Welcome to a brand new series called Understanding Underwater. If you have a look over my right shoulder, you'll see a dredger, and yes, that is the dredger, and yes, this is the Wraysbury South Lake. What a fantastic place to be, and we're here for a number of reasons. It's crystal clear, there's quite a few fish in it, and you're going to come on a session with me where I'm going to encounter the same problems that everyone else does, but this time, as soon as I do, I'm going to ask the question, go below the surface and see if I can find out the answer. So this is my plot for the next 24 hours, and this is the iconic Hut Island. Now I'm on the point of it, facing directly over to Bryant's Bay. No Carp Bay is over to my right, Dredger Bay behind me, swimming pool up there. They're all very, very iconic names. But the thing is, I've chosen this spot because I've got a great amount of water in front of me, real big amount of vision, and the wind has started to pick up. The weather, as you can see, is pretty messy at the moment. It's brilliant carp fishing conditions. The pressure's dropped over the last few days. It's got a lot cooler. The wind is blowing strong from the south and southwest, and there's a fair amount of cloud and rain in it as well. And here, it's basically a really nice sweep where I think the fish are going to come out of the two areas that they like to sit in, which is up there on the swimming pool and out to the right-hand side, which is No Carp Bay. The first thing I do as soon as I get to a lake is I have a look in the edge, because if it's clear, you can guarantee there's weed. And I know very well from swimming in Wraysbury before, there's a lot of weed out there. Now, I've never fished this peg before, so it's going to be a learning curve for me. So the first thing I'd like to know is what's out there. Now, I'm going to do it with a marker float. I'm going to find my spots with a marker float, because that's what we would do. But what I'm also going to do is have a little swim around, and this is what's below the surface here. When you look above, it looks lovely, but just check this out. This is what it looks like below the surface. Well, straight away, just look at that. You can see there's a fair amount of weed around. The other thing is the water's quite clear too. Now, just have a look laterally. When you look across water, this is what I see all the time. You can't see for a long way. There's always a bit of mug in the water, whatever that might be. Now, here's the first interesting spot. Just have a look at that. Gone across a load of weed, and then I found a sandy area with a low-lying amount of weed over the top of it. Cast into that, you'll feel a bit of a donk, but it will be soft. In Wraysbury in particular, there's loads of little holes like that, but I don't necessarily think the fish feed in them. When you have a look down there, there's nothing to show the fish have been down and fed on that spot, but I'm sure they'll visit it. These are like the little channels that they pass through, and you get these wherever there's weedy lakes. Just have a look at this. This is a spot they definitely feed in. I see these all the time. This is a clay scratching spot, and if you look closely, you can see the marks in it there where the fish have been flanking their dorsals and their pecs on it. Find a clay spot, you know what? You're on the money. Let's have a look at this as well. Big lump of gravel, and then there's a big stick on it with a load of razor mussels too. That'll cut you off like an absolute shot if you tight line over the top of that. So if there's mussels around, just be very, very aware. Have a look how sharp they are. I can feel them even through the gloves. Not good. Right, so the first thing I've got to do now is try and find a spot out there. And once again, from experience with Wraysbury, you don't just chuck out anywhere, because there's weed all over the place, and random chucks at showing fish inevitably end up and you're burying yourself in weed. Absolute no-go. So for me, I really do like using a marker float. Now, a lot of people say that marker floats are carp scarers, that they can get away with just leading. That might be the case, but you find out so much more if you use a float properly. For a start, you know exactly what depth it is, and that makes a big difference. Secondly, you can feel the bumps back, and yes, I know you can with a lead. Sometimes it's better with just a lead than with a float, but you get a bigger picture with a float. But there is a question as to whether or not marker floats are carp scarers. Well, just to prove the point, let's have a look at what they look like underwater. Right, well, first up, it's the orange one, and you can see that it's really, really obvious. Second up now is the yellow one. That is a lot better. You know, in tinged water, it's very well disguised. And then let's have a look at the black one from a distance. That's the same distance as the other two, but you really can't see it that much. And now we've moved a meter closer just to show you how discreet that float is. And that's a point proved perfectly. If the water is crystal clear, then the best thing to do is go with the dark green and the black tips. Rig's going to be dead simple, and I'll just run through it quickly. Dressen X in 34 pound 15 kilo as a leader, because there's a lot of weed out there. Clip system, and then I've got just a standard 3 ounce lead there. Sand coated, actually, same colour as the gravel down in front of us, although it might land in weed, but they're used to seeing this colour. Business end, now that is 10 inches of Combi Soft in 20 green, and then I've got a ready tied choddy with a small pink hit and run on it. And the idea is that lead lands and that will slowly sink down, and because it's on a ready tied choddy, the short one, it'll sit just over the top of any silkweed that's out there. I'm expecting there to be a bit of weed, not really, really big thick stuff, but just silkweed. So I'm gonna bang this one out over the top. I've clipped it at 14.8 and I've been baiting up with a spon at 14.5. So there's about 3-4 foot difference, and this is where it's got to be absolutely bang on. It's gone on the right line, hit the clip, come back down again, feel it down, bang, that's gone down with a crack. That's exactly where I want it, and I'm very, very happy with that. I reckon that when I go out there, that's going to be on a hard patch, and having had a few flicks around with the lead just before, I found that there's a load of weed around it. There's a hard spot with a bit of rock, and there is also a little bit of silkweed as well. Now, there's a bit of a crosswind coming at me, and if this drifts either right or left, I can live with silkweed because of the rig. If it goes in a weed, that's a game over one. It's got to come back in again. But the harder that donk, the better it is. And I'm happy with that. I'm convinced that'll be a bite. Right then, let's go and have a little look at my spot, and you can see the colour of the water now is ever so slightly different to what it was before. That's due to a light change above. Coming in over the weed, you can see my spot there perfectly, and if you look carefully, more or less in the middle of the pick now, you'll be able to see that pink bait standing out really well. That is one of the reasons why pink is so good, particularly the shade of it. It is just perfect. It's not too obvious, but it stands out enough for the fish to want to investigate it. As we come down, you can see why that is such a good spot. Hard gravel, that has actually been fed on there. A lot of the gravel and stones have been moved off it. But if you look around the spot, you'll see that fluffy candy floss weed. Sometimes when you cast out and you're on what you think is your hard spot, but it lands with a little bit of a cushioned bump, this is what you're finding. Let's go down and have a look at the rig itself though. I'm on the hinge, it looks lovely. It's leaning over there, the hook is just caught, but it won't really affect the presentation too much. There's one little pellet there as well. And if I just lift this hook bait and drop it back down again, you'll see exactly what it will look like. Just whizzing around the rest of the peg, I'm gonna come back to this candy floss weed, because when the fish feed on this, this is what they'll clean off. And with a bit of bait application, they'll move that off everywhere. But just be careful, because it does move around the peg. And if you don't recast fairly regularly, you could get caught up on it. Heavier gravel towards the top of the spot as well, and that would feel a really, really big crack down as and when you're casting out. but that light weed can be moved off it really, really easily. Like I say, with the movement of the fish's pecs, as and when they come on, that'll clean that off. And this is the sort of spot that would develop really, really well and be a perfect one. As you look off to the side, you can see the big, heavy weed. And if you cast off the spot and it doesn't land with a really hard crack, that's what you're in. And it is just never, ever gonna get you a bite. It's no good being out there at all. You've got to feel that crack down. Make sure it lands perfectly well. This is that weed again, just close look at it, you can see it rolls up, it's filamentous algae. And when you reel in with a little bit of this on, this is basically what it looks like on the deck. Pop-ups are needed. If you put a bottom bait on there, it'll probably end up covered in this stuff. A bit of sand, that looks like a fish has fed there at some stage in the not too distant past. And then once again, just look, distant shot looking down there, that pink bait stands out perfectly. In this sort of water quality, pink is just a winner. Wow, this rod has just absolutely melted off. If you have a look down there, I haven't got any other rods out. I've only put this one out, and it was about 20 minutes, maybe half an hour ago. Obviously, it felt really good when it landed, and I thought there's a chance, but the problem that I've got now is that it's picked my marker float up. I've got a rescue boat down here. Obviously, we're diving, we need a boat with us. So I've got a boat down there. I think what I'm gonna have to do is take to the boat and see if I can get this out, because I can't see anything other than a disaster happening if I don't get out there. Sticking half a dozen spoms in. Half a dozen spoms is a lot of the go-to method just for kicking a swim up, and as soon as it started then I can top it up with a little bit more. But the big question is, how much is six spoms? Well, you know what, I've got a spom, I've got a tray, let's find out. Six spoms, that's it. Doesn't actually look that much when you think about it, especially when you spread it over quite a wide area. Now, I like to think that I'm pretty good at casting, fairly accurate, that they're going to go in a reasonable tight area. But I bet you when I put these six out there, when you think about the spread of them going through the water, you know, it's 12 foot deep, 13 foot deep out there. So it's going to be a fair old spread with them going down. How do the boilies sink? Do they spread differently to the pellets? Do the heavy pellets go down? Do the smaller ones go straight and the bigger ones go wider? I don't know. Let's get these six spoms in. And then after we've done that, I'll go out and have a look and see exactly what the spread is. Right then, let's get straight down to the bottom now and have a look exactly what this bait looks like. Six spoms. What's the spread like? And immediately you can see there that it's not actually that obvious. Full spom gone in there, you can see the pellets, one or two of the pink boilies, but actually it doesn't really stand out that well over the top of that hard gravel, and bits of it have got caught in the weed. But that is spom number one. Now they were pretty accurate. Let's have a look there, spom number two, and you can see once again a big old clump of bait caught up in the weed. That's not a problem. What'll happen over a period of time is the fish will come in, pick that bait out of that weed, and their movement of picking the bait out and also the fanning of their fins and tails will just clear all of that off. And I've seen it before where fish have come in and cleared a whole bucket of bait off a spot, almost turfing it, just rolling that bait off to the side. That's number three. Look, that's fallen on the gravel, and actually you can hardly see that at all. So it's interesting, the bait falling in the weed is more obvious than the bait that's falling onto the gravel itself. The weed can actually help you to begin with. Look at that there, that's number four. Once again, some on the gravel, some in the weed. Spom number four, it's fallen in an area around about the size, not quite, of an old school dustbin lid. There's number five just off to one side. Now, they looked like they were absolutely bang on the money going down the same hole. The reality of it is they're probably 6-8 foot apart out there, and six bombs, well, quite frankly, it's just absolutely nothing. Just look at it there, they can hardly see anything. Tip rods are out on the spots, ready to rock and roll. Fingers crossed for a good night. Obviously, the weather's closing in a little bit now. It's forecast to be fairly hefty rain, but very, very good carp fishing conditions. Wind might pick up as well. So, you know, we're hopeful that there may be a fish or two. What have I learned so far? Well, the spot out there on the left-hand rod isn't far off what I thought it might be. What surprised me about that was how much bait was either not there or alternatively had been eaten or was hard to find. So as a result, I've given that a bit more of a tickle, stuck a few more spods out over the top of that just to regenerate that area. The right hand area, that feels quite nice. I've not had a look at that one yet. That feels quite nice. It feels quite let's say sandy stroke soft. It's not rock hard, it's not cracking down, but it is going down and it feels presentable. So yeah, let's see what the night brings, and I'll see you in the morning, maybe even before. Well, first light now. The prep last night's obviously worked very well, because I had a couple through the early hours of the morning. But first light is at this time of year when everything absolutely comes to light, and I've just had an absolute melter. You know, one of those ones where it is nothing and then it was just flying, absolutely flying. There's a bit of weed out there at the moment, and it's a bit of a case of, as soon as you hook into it, just try and slow it down, even though this thing was absolutely ripping, and I've come up here as quickly as possible just to get the tip in the air and get it out of that weed. And there is a bit flying like a flag on that line. But we're on, game on, carp on. I thought from the take he wasn't going to be a big fish. It was an absolute melt for that one. Steering through that gap. And he's in. Lovely, double bubble this morning. That's happy days. Well, back again, same place, same position. And guess what? Same rod as well, left-hander. Just had that fish, what, half an hour ago? Three quarters of an hour ago, I suppose. Popped a fresh bait back out over the top of it. And lo and behold, it's cracked off. Once again, it's going left this one. It might cause me a bit of trouble if it goes down that margin down there. But I'm not seeing any signs of fish over the spot. I'm seeing them behind in the dark water over that far side, but clearly they are coming in. They're not big, but they're some of the strongest little carp that I've fished for recently. Absolutely bionic, full of beams. Got him. Oh, bionic, absolutely bionic. Wow, there he is. You can have a look at this one straight away. Angry little male, full of beans, full of energy, full of pellet as well, by the look. Proper been troughing. Right, allow me to introduce you to one incredibly angry carp. 23 pounds, 6 ounces, this one. And this is one that kicked off the action. And this fought like an absolute creature. If I'd have lost it, I would have sworn blind it was 30 pound plus without any shadow of doubt. One of the old Wraysbury originals, an absolute tank. But it wasn't, it was this creature. And this is what started it off, like I said. Found the spot. Got the rod on it, went down with a nice donk, happy days, caught a fish, put it back out, caught another one. And it's just kicked off on that left-hand side. It's been really, really, really productive. Just repeating the same process. Same bait out there, just popped up off the deck, avoiding the stones and the silkweed. And a little tickle of pellet over the top of it as well. Top up now and again, perfect. Absolute peach. And this one came in the early hours of the morning, actually. I had a bit of a run through the early hours. Had a couple of three bites, which was brilliant. And it was interesting seeing how the one spot has differed from the other spot. Now, this one came from the right-hand rod. And I have to confess that I did lose a fish on it earlier on. I had a bite probably around about midnight, and it did me in the weed, which was a bit of a pest, but I chucked it back out again. It cracked down really well, and this was the result. And as soon as it landed, I knew that it was all right. Now after this, I cast it back out again, and it didn't quite land as well. And would you believe it, that rod hasn't gone since. So need to investigate that a little bit further. For the moment though, let's just feast our eyes on this absolutely beautiful girl. So let's have a look at the other spot and find out exactly why that didn't work. And I'm going in along the line, and I just want to show you what lines look like below the surface. Bear in mind, this line has been in, what, 12, 15 hours maybe. It's already picked up a reasonable amount of dirt and debris from the surface. Fluorocarbons do it even more than nylon lines. So it's always worthwhile just giving your line a little bit of a clean as and when it comes in. I don't think it's too much of a problem here, because it's in the upper layers of the water, quite close under the rod tip. And as you go further below the surface, there seems to be less debris round, so it doesn't pick up as much. But just look at that. It's amazing how much it picks it up. And if you don't give it a clean off, then actually it does, I think, have a bit of an effect, because your lines get dirty, they don't cast as well. So just bear that one in mind. But anyway, let's just carry on down there. A little bit of weed hanging on the line. Nothing wrong with that. There's all sorts of bits of floating down. And then when we get down to the business end, you actually lose sight of the line itself when it's closer to the spot. And this is the spot that I've been looking for. Now, I felt that it was fairly hard. It didn't feel like gravel. And this is exactly what it is. It's a sandy spot. Absolutely fantastic. There's a spot that a fish has fed on. You can see how the weed has just been pushed back, and that will be the action of the fish's fins, its tail, just when it's flicked away. And you know what? It wouldn't surprise me if that wasn't where the bite was. If you just have a look there, you can see there's been a bit of extra disturbance, and that's almost certainly where my bait was through the course of the night when I had that bite earlier. Just look at this though. We saw one of these earlier. This is a scratching spot, absolutely superb. Didn't know that was there. If I did and I'd have landed on that, you know what, that's almost certainly another bite as well. And it's probably because of this that I had the bite so close to it. Fish just love to visit these clay scratching spots. So if you can find them, get on them. The big question though is, where's my rig? I just can't find it anywhere. And after, I've got to say, a good 10 minutes of swimming up and down, I eventually saw the line disappear into this. Basically, I've missed my spot. I felt it going, it felt a little bit softer than it was previously, but it was buried down in the bottom of there. And for anybody thinking, oh, just chuck a PVA bag into weed, you'll be all right, or don't worry about it, the cast's more or less right, it isn't. This is a perfect example of why it's got to be back on the spot. Just had another belt intake again. And this one's a really interesting experiment, this one. This is the first time this rod's gone. This is the middle rod. And it's presented in a very similar way to the others. Nice little spot. Bit of bait around the top of it. Pellet. But this is a yellow bait. The other two have been pink. And between those other two, there's been 9 bites. Between those other two. And this is the first one on yellow. Why is that then? We know they work, but I firmly believe that at certain times fish like certain colours. Oh, it's gone in the weed. That's badly weeded now. Oh, it's coming. The thing when they're weeded is just keep the pressure on. And a lot of the time when I've been diving, I've seen when they've gone in, they've poked the head into the weed and literally the line is just at a dodgy angle. So if you just keep the pressure on and they reverse back out of it, there's a chance of getting that fish back. And he's on his way in now. He's actually coming quite quick. Changed his mind. Banging conditions at the moment. Really, really good conditions. We've had thunderstorms over the last few days. Got low pressure coming now. Good wind just blowing in towards us, southerly. And the fish are on the feed. This is when they want food. You know, there's times to feed them and there's times to trap fish. And at the moment, they definitely want grub, and pellets at this time of year are brilliant. There he is, that's in. Oh, he looks a good fish actually. What more can you ask for? Wraysbury, overcast, lovely margins. Cracking dark scaly mirror. Now if that's not carpy, nothing is. Well, I've just had another bite and it's caught me up in the weed. And it does feel pretty solid out there at the moment. So rather than pulling and pulling and pulling, I've got the boat down there. Obviously we're using it for safety and also for the filming for the underwater stuff. So I've got the boat there. I'm actually going to go out and see if I can rescue it. If it does feel like it's still on. Obviously I do quite a lot of this on the continent when I'm out, and the key thing is stay low in the boat, stay at the front of it, and then I'll just pull myself to the fish. I'll use the engine if I need to in the wind. Now that is a corker. Well, I'm back and I've got to say, this is just an absolute worldie. Perler of a fish, linear, just wow. Just wow, that's all I can say. This place is amazing. You know, it's got the history in the past. It's going through its renaissance at the moment. And the fish in here now, wow, they're just amazing. You know, this is 20 odd pounds, but at some stage in the future, these things are going to be 30s. And then, my word, this place is going to be somewhere special. But for the time being, that is how you do it with a boat, straight over the top of them. As soon as you get pressure directly above the fish, most of the time it will lift straight out and you're in contact with it. It's just trying to pull it back along. It's a bit like an anchor, you know, when the anchor's down, you can't pull it along, but you get above it, you can pull it up, no problem whatsoever. So if you do get them stuck in the weed, if you pull it, the chances are it ain't gonna come out. You've gotta get high and keep steady pressure on it and hope for the fish to work its way out. Or if you've got access to one, get in a boat. Always the easiest way. absolutely fantastic. And I'm afraid that is it for this edition of Underwater Answers. I think we've answered a few, to be fair. And if you've got any questions that you'd like us to look at or me to answer, then feel free to get in touch with us. We're always looking for things to feature in this. So have a look at my YouTube channel, Rob Hughes TV, or alternatively, of course, Dynamite Baits and Carp Spirit as well. You can find more information about Dynamite at dynamitebaits.com and Carp Spirit at carpspirit.com. So until next time, have a good one. See you soon.